My name is Aaron Cato, and I'm the Integrated Pest Management Specialist for Horticulture Crops here at the University of Arkansas System Division of Agriculture. And today we're at the Southwest Research and Extension Center. This is down here in Hope, Arkansas. We're standing in some tomato trials that we're doing, and these are focusing on caterpillar pests. And so these are insects that are caterpillars that feed on the leaves and the fruit. And these are ones that you probably often deal with in your own tomato plantings. And so today I hope to share with you some tips and tricks on scouting for these pests and dealing with them before they become a problem, which as you can see with this tomato right here is they can cause a lot of damage, not only to the fruit, but then also to some of these plants, to the leaves, and just kind of overall affect the health of them. So mostly what we deal with here in Arkansas are the tomato fruit worm, which is Helicoverpizea, the yellow striped army worm, tomato or tobacco hornworm, mostly tobacco hornworm, and then also some cabbage loopers. For each of these pests, there's a specific way to scout for them. There's a specific way to control them, and then they usually come with specific thresholds. A little bit about identification of the different caterpillars you'll find. There's a lot of things that feed on tomato. The caterpillars generally are gonna be the ones that can cause damage really quickly. And there's also something we can usually do something about. And so first, tomato fruit worm, it's gonna be green or yellow. We usually say that it has four prolegs. These are ones that we are 100% sure they're going to move to your fruit or move into the stem even and cause some pretty significant damage. And they're really what we call a key pest, or the one you wanna base your decisions around. Next, we have yellow-striped army worm. You can identify these by the black dot you see on the side, usually right behind their true legs. And then as they get larger, you'll see a large yellow stripe that comes down the side of the insect. These mostly we see feeding at the bottom of the plants. The moths will fly in and lay eggs at the bottom of the plant in large egg masses covered egg masses. Then they will move up the plant and eventually they will get into the fruit, especially later into the year. And so they don't just feed on foliage, although they will do a lot of that. They will also feed on fruit. Cabbage looper is very similar. The eggs are at the very bottom of the plant. That's where the moths are laying eggs, on the underside of leaves for the most part. But they will move up the plant, and sometimes you can find their eggs maybe halfway up the plant. They almost exclusively feed on leaves though, but they can very quickly defoliate or eat the leaves off a plant. And then the last defoliator we'll talk about, or leaf feeding caterpillar, is tobacco or tomato hornworm. And you can see this one side of this plant here, maybe you're able to see that many of the leaves are gone. And so this was fed on all the way through to its last instar by tobacco hornworm, and they can quickly cause a lot of damage. But not just damage to the plant itself, they can also damage fruit as they are feeding. They'll come by and just scrape the outsides of fruit and cause them to become unmarketable. A lot of times what I see is that if you're finding one every 10 or so plants, that's probably at enough level that you probably want to do something about it. Their eggs are very easily identifiable. They're at the tops of the plants, and they're probably about 5 times or larger than a cornworm egg, and they're usually clear. Then they come to get a bit milky green before they hatch, and so they're much easier to identify for. The main one we'll talk about is corn earworm or tomato fruit worm. You'll often hear it called corn earworm, tomato fruit worm, soybean pod worm. It's all the exact same species, but it just feeds on a lot of different crops that we grow. Generally, what we want to recommend is that people try to control for this before you start finding it in your fruit. And so oftentimes you will see it feeding on leaves, moving on to flowers, then onto fruit. And the way that you can target it before it gets to that point is by looking for its eggs. The eggs are generally about 0.5 millimeter in size. I know that sounds very small, but you can find them if you look. They're usually on the top of the canopy, so right on the top of the leaves. You can find it maybe about halfway down in the leaves, but usually kind of north near the top. They take about 3 to 4 days to hatch. And so if you're scouting at least twice a week, you can usually find these eggs before they move to these very small larvae that are almost impossible to find in any good number. So you always want to look for those eggs and target your preventative or really managing insecticide applications based on that. And we actually, threshold has been developed. I believe Virginia Tech was the people who field tested that. But if you're finding an egg on 1 out of 10 plants, so 10% of your tomato plants are infested with eggs, then that's a level that's going to be damaging enough to warrant an insecticide application. Outside of that, finding larvae is going to be another way. If you're looking through your tomato plants and you're looking especially at the fruit and you're finding larvae on them, this is going to indicate that you need to do something to control for that. And so like this tomato right here, it's been fed on. This is a damaged tomato. We could assume that it's maybe corn or tomato fruit worm, but we wouldn't be 100% certain. It could also be yellow-striped armyworm or something else. If you're finding three out of every 100 damaged fruit or fruit you look at, three of them are damaged, then that means you need to make an insecticide application to control for them. And so what do you do about them? I just told you about thresholds, when you should spray for these things, but what should you apply? And so what we always recommend is to not apply insecticides unless you have an issue. There's a lot of products that can control caterpillars. We usually want to base our product selection around tomato fruit worm because it is the hardest to control. And then yellow-striped armyworm and cabbage looper are probably some that are close, at a close second on what product actually will control it. The best products that are very caterpillar specific and don't kill our natural enemies or flare mites or flare aphids are going to be our diamides. And so this is going to be like Coragen or Exoril. Both of these products have chlorine and chinilipril in it, make them earn our diamides. Other pretty good products are going to be our spinosad based products like Radiant. And then also things like BT can be a little bit softer, not really hurt our natural enemies, but generally you're not going to get very good control. Tomato fruit worm and yellow-striped armyworm are pretty resistant to BT products. Whereas things like our tobacco hornworm, probably we can get a little bit better control with those types of products. Pyrethroids are what most people use that you hear about. So things like bifenthrin, lambda psi halothrin, or gamma psi permethrin. All of these things, or zeta psi permethrin would be a better one. All of these things work pretty decently on most of the species I just listed. But tomato fruit worm is resistant, especially here in Arkansas, but also in many other parts of the country, is resistant to this mode of action or this chemistry of insecticide. In our trials here, we sprayed some plots every single week, which is a practice a lot of growers do when they don't scout, with lambda psi halothrin, and we're still seeing a good number of worms make it through that. Actually more than just one application of our Coragen or corn chinilipril-based product. And so we don't recommend for people to only rely on pyrethroids for control of our worms, especially if you're finding actual corn or tomato fruit worms out here. There are many other options you can find. I always recommend first looking at the Southeastern Vegetable Handbook, and there are actual efficacy tables and recommendations based on what's labeled. And then look for your specific state. So here in Arkansas, look for the MP-144. We have a lot of options in there that gives you ideas of what you can use to manage. But always remember that if you are putting out an insecticide for caterpillars, make sure you have enough out there to warrant it, because you're trying to manage these populations and keep them at levels that aren't damaging. Because when you do make an insecticide application, there's a good chance you'll flare other species of pests like mites or aphids. And the other side of that too is make sure you're also scouting for other insect pests that aren't just caterpillar pests. So a good example are stink bugs. We actually have a good number of stink bugs out here. Many of our caterpillar only products don't control stink bugs. And so if you have stink bugs that you're finding, and so if you're out in your field and you're seeing stink bugs, that's pretty much the level you need to be spraying at. And so if you're finding them, then you need to be using combinations of products or products that, like a pyrethroid, that will control both. Beyond that, you know, make sure you scout all the way through when picking. We've already picked some red fruit off of these plants, or fruit that are beginning to redden a bit, and we're still seeing lots of yellow-striped armyworms and lots of tomato fruit worms still coming on and eggs being laid. There's actually a moth that was in the plant right here beside me still laying eggs for tomato fruit worms. So it's something you really have to see through the end until you're done pretty much harvesting food.